Thank you again to Dr. Pardiwala. And we move from orthopedics now to neurosurgery. Our next speaker is Professor Dr. Paresh K. Doshi, Director of Neurosurgery and Functional Neurosurgery, Jaslok Hospital and Research Center, Group Advisor, Functional Neurosurgery, Apollo Hospitals. Dr. Paresh Doshi is a leading neurosurgeon and pioneer of stereotactic and functional neurological surgery in India. Since 1999, he's been in charge of stereotactic and functional neurosurgery program at Jaslok Hospital, the only dedicated and comprehensive stereotactic and functional neurological program in India. Dr. Doshi is also the director of neurosurgery at Jaslok Hospital and Research Center. Dr. Doshi has been credited for conducting several path-breaking surgeries in the field of neurosurgery. He has conducted over 650 stereotactic surgeries, including 450 deep brain stimulation surgeries. And he's been credited with several firsts in India. Bring your hands together and welcome Dr. Paresh Doshi.
Thank you for that very nice and kind introduction. It's really an honor to be here, sharing some of the thoughts that I have on neurosciences today evening. Neurosurgery is a branch where people relate neurosurgery to mainly brain tumors, trauma, and highly morbid outcome. And whenever a patient undergoes neurosurgical procedure, I'm sure everyone and anyone over here would think that probably the outcome is likely to be compromised, and everyone is skeptical and scared. Today, what I'm going to share with you is something very different and unique. We are going to talk about three different people or six different people in their way of life. This is a gentleman, 70 plus, who said that either I leave from your hospital in a good shape or I will not leave your hospital, completely disabled. There is another person here who is a gynecologist who is losing confidence in treating patients because the moment the patient saw his tremor in the hands, they would leave him and that brought back a great sorrow and misery in his own life. Or this musician, can I have the sound please here? Sound, please. No? I can't see here the sound, so. So that musician was a devout Sikh person who had dedicated his life to two things. One is teaching music, and second was playing this tabla in Gurudwara. And what happened to him was, when you see him, that his index and middle finger, which are the most critical for playing tabla, had got affected with a disease called focal hand dystonia. And this is a very typical dystonia which only affects to a particular part of the body, and especially for the profession that the person is used to carrying it out. Sorry for that interruption, but as I said, it's critical to the presentation, so we had to wait for a few minutes. Or we take the story of these four different people. One is a Benjamin Ward, who approached to us in 2013 from Australia with suffering from severe depression. Or this gentleman who had not signed or not had a bath for...
And unable to take bath for a long time.
How many days? What is the longest you must not have taken bath?
This last month, 1.5 months.
Right? So not taken bath for 90 days. Or this gentleman who was a transporter who was losing his business because of severe migraine that he suffered. Or this young boy who was a dropout of the school or almost a dropout of the school because of severe epilepsy that he was suffering from. So all of them had different role to play in the society, but they were all having one common thing, and they were losing their dignity. And what could bring back this dignity is a branch of functional neurosurgery, which aims at restoring this function of neurological patients. And what it deals is movement disorders, epilepsy, spasticity, chronic pain, and psychiatric disorders. So I will give you a brief glimpses of all that. It was in 1998 that I came back from England fresh with a lot of aspirations and hopes to set up something unique in India, and that was not available. And it was these two gentlemen, Mr. M.K. Chandrai, the trustee and chairman of Jaslok Hospital and Chandrai Group, and late Professor Noshir Wadia, the doyen of neurology, both had put in confidence in me and appointed me to Jaslok Hospital to set up the functional neurosurgical program. So we talk about very quickly about movement disorder surgery. These are three common movement disorders that we treat with surgery: Parkinson's disease, dystonia, and tremors. The target that we use in the brain are very small and less than half the size of the thumbnail, the subthalamic nucleus or the thalamus or the globus pallidus internus. And the surgery involves basically implantation of two electrodes in the brain through a small hole called burr hole. The electrodes are implanted. They are connected through a wire to a pacemaker, the same like what you use for cardiac disorders, and that stimulates the brain and controls the movement disorder. This is a capsule of 1 minute of surgery. It's done under local anesthesia. Patient is fully awake without any discomfort because of the local anesthesia. A stereotactic frame is applied. The patient is taken for an MRI scan wherein the target is located, and then the planning is carried out. And then through a small hole on the top of the head, we perform a microelectrode recording from single cell of the brain. And that gives us the signature of the target's nucleus. Once we have got that, we try to see what improvement we can achieve. These are wires which are being advanced at sub-millimeter accuracy, and you can see the recordings at different channels. The patient had slowness of movement. Parkinson's disease causes slowness of movement. You can see that I'm testing a baseline slowness of movement. The patient has got bradykinesia, what we call it, and rigidity. You can see that when I move her wrist, the wrist movement is not smooth. Once I get to stimulate this area, you would see the instantaneous improvement. There is a loss of resistance now. The wrist has become soft and supple. The patient can now turn a hand very freely. So I know that I have hit the target and I'm bang there where I should be. Once I've got there, I implant an electrode as I showed you earlier through the video, and then the patient carries on. So what happened to this gentleman, gynecologist that we saw earlier? He went back after surgery to perform surgery on his own. He could go back, and here you can see on the bottom video, if it is possible for you to see, that he is able to operate on his own independently without any tremors and complete a hysterectomy, as you will see at the end. There was an American soldier who had lost his job, and he could not be operated in US at that time because US FDA came in 2002, the approval for deep brain stimulation. So he came to us. You can see that he's quite slow on the right-hand side before surgery. He's not able to walk. There is shuffling of gait. And on the other side, you can see that he's able to run around immediately after surgery. And what happened to this gentleman who wasn't able to get up also? You can see how slow his movements are, hardly able to get up. He required two people to help him. And the same patient, 2 years later, the moment he was operated, he became so well that he left Mumbai and shifted to Devlali because his vision was that he wanted to do some charity and social work. And he went off to Devlali and stayed there and never came back to Mumbai. Only he used to come back to Mumbai to meet us and adjust his medication or programming. So you can see that even 2 years later, with a minimal help, he could get up. And the person who was not able to walk got the dignity back of being independent. There has always been a question mark as to what is the outcome in elderly patients, because these are challenging cases. World over, this patient that I showed you probably would not have been operated in US or in Europe because of the challenges that they face. So we had to publish our work in Journal of Clinical Neurosciences, where we showed that the outcome of our patients was more or less same as for the younger patient. I talked to you about the drummer. It is called a task-specific dystonia. Basically, the hand goes into an abnormal posturing, especially when the patient tries to perform an activity which he is supposed to be doing daily. So for a surgeon, when he uses a scalpel, for a clerk, when he writes, for a musician, when he plays music. But if he tries to eat with that hand, the hand is normal. So we'll see this, what happened to this. Now he's going to describe. You can see the curling. Anywhere he would do that action, he would get that. So he underwent a surgery called ventro-oralis anterior thalamotomy, and this is the video. As I said, we test the improvement prior on the operation table. And then he continued, he went back to doing his work that he loved so much. And this is one of the difficult modes, rhythm of tabla, that is what I was told. And he could play it very smoothly, even 2 years down the line. Once again, these are very unique cases. We have the second largest series in the world, published in two very reputed journals, Annals of Indian Academy of Neurology and Movement Disorder Clinical Practice. We talk about epilepsy. Epilepsy is basically a short circuit in the brain, and the aim of the surgeon is to remove that short circuit. That's in a nutshell. Now, what happened to this young boy? You can see that one half of his brain was damaged. You can, even if you do not know medicine, you can see there is a difference. The gray part or the black part is a normal brain, and the white is a liquefied brain matter, which is completely damaged at the time of birth because of some injury. Because of that, he suffered intractable epilepsy, continuous seizures, and he could not be controlled with any medical treatment. The only solution that we have in this case was to disconnect the abnormal brain from the normal brain, and it is called hemispherotomy. If I would have told anybody, people would have thought that that would have led to a paralysis because you remove one part of the brain or disconnect completely. But this is a video which shows that probably the boy is no worse than what he was before the surgery, with a minimal limp on the left side. But apart from that, he was able to walk, and he continued to go back to school and continued to do education. Even 6 years later, when we had a follow-up of him, he was seizure-free. We now come to psychiatric disorder surgery. This is a very difficult area and a very upcoming area, probably having a lot of promise because large amount of patients are suffering from obsessive-compulsive disorders and depression. So this is a graph of scientific papers that had been published before the era of chlorpromazine, that was between 65 and 85. Before 1965, there was a large number of material available for psychiatric disorder surgery because there was no medicine and surgery was the only solution. The publications went down later on, and then later on, once the deep brain stimulation surgery came, which was perceived to be a little reversible therapy, the interest has been increased. We thought about pursuing this, but we had our own concerns. So in 2009, we had a group meeting of all the top psychiatrists of the country, around 20 of them, and we came up with the guidelines or the plan as to how this should be performed in our country. We were 2 years ahead of the World Society. You can see here that in World Society of Functional Neurosurgery, they convened a same kind of meeting to develop guidelines on psychiatric surgery in 2011. We had a follow-through on this later on in 2018, where we had a larger group of around 60 psychiatrists signing up on two papers that we published. One, this paper on a consensus of guidelines in psychiatric surgery was published with our efforts in 2013. And the second paper in Indian Journal of Psychiatry was published in 2018. Sorry, the first was in 2013 and the second in 2018 with the help of 60 psychiatrists. This tells us what is the current status of psychiatric disorder surgeries in the world. around handful of cases and only handful of centers perform this surgery because these are very challenging cases and only some cases can be offered surgery. Not all patients of depression or OCD can be offered surgery. So around 300, 400 odd cases have been operated. We have an experience of around 14 patients in our setup at Jaslok Hospital. This is the OCD patients that I showed you earlier. Sound, please.
Without contamination, frequent washing of hands.
That is
asking the repeatedly, asking the same thing again and again. If somebody comes, checking whether he is gone correctly or not, checking things again and again.
How many times you want to check?
Once I start the checking or testing, it, I cannot stop. It goes on.
Once he starts checking, he cannot stop.
Unable to take bath for a long time.
That we heard, unable to take bath for a long time. And this is him after surgery. Any obsessions now or obsessive thoughts?
No.
Not now?
No.
Okay.
You can write your name.
He signed after 15 years or so. After how many years you must have signed? Then we talk about the patient of depression who came all the way from Australia because he wrote to me in the letter that this surgery is not available in Australia and the psychiatrist in Australia recommended that only one center probably would take up this kind of case and that too would be India because in US also again it was not available. So we offered him surgery and this is him 3 years later.
Hi, my name is Ben Ward. I struggled for depression for over 5 years. I tried about 15 medications. I had electroconvulsive therapy and nothing was working. I was just getting worse and worse. I was really suicidal. And yeah, I had no options left in Australia. And that's what I heard about Dr. Doshi's deep brain stimulation surgery that's being done in India. And then I sent him an email and contacted him. And yeah, then we went over with my parents and I had deep brain stimulation for depression there. That surgery, it worked so well. It saved my life and I'm 100% better now. I'm not taking any medicine and I got married and yeah, I'm working and yeah, life's great at the moment.
He got married and he also became a partner in his office. This may be a little disturbing video, so be careful. This is a patient having a Tourette syndrome. Basically, we all have some kind of tic. Some people have tic of lifting the shoulder, some have grimacing tics. This patient had an extreme tic. These are complete involuntary movements. And this is him after surgery.
Hello, my name is Jitendra Sethi and it's been 2 months of my operation and all the Tourette syndrome symptoms are under control and I'm feeling much relaxed and I'm looking forward for my future.
And the last case that, two cases actually. One is the autism. Autism is a very widespread disorder. This patient came from US, a 42-year-old lady with autism, aggression, and obsessive-compulsive disorder. We had offered her surgery mainly for obsessive-compulsive disorder, which did improve, but her autism also improved in line with that. And this is what her sister said. The waiter did namaste with folded hands, and she did namaste back. Which is the first time that I have seen appropriate communication since she became autistic at the age of 3 years. So that was a reward, and Government of India did recognize this, and we were awarded a FICCI award for this. Thank you. I can go on and on. This is the level of number of surgeries where I apply deep brain stimulation or functional neurosurgeries, and many of the diseases you may have seen, something very unique or difficult or disturbing like persistent vegetative state or deeply comatose patient. and many other things. The last case is about the migraine. I talked to you about this gentleman who had been suffering from severe migraine with 20 to 25 tablets a day for 20 days a month. He underwent something, a very simple procedure. We implanted electrodes at the back of the head. You can see two electrodes here, small wires there. And these wires gave current and controlled the migraine pain. And this is what he had to say 2 years down the line. I have translated in English also.
For whole 1 year.
So no medicine, no stimulation. Functional neurosurgery, and especially stereotactic surgery, is like this picture. This is a picture, a perfect shot by ace photographer Alan McFadden. It took him 6 years, 720,000 shot to get this perfect dive of a kingfisher. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Doshi. It's amazing the kind of work you're doing, and some of those visuals and those videos were actually, you know, making people take so much of keen interest, and I think people were overawed that this is actually happening today, and it's almost as if there's a solution for everything. So great work. Thank you very much. Request Satya Brahma to come forward and honor Dr. Paresh Doshi, please. Thank you, Dr. Doshi, again. And ladies and gentlemen, we've had three wonderful presentations from the most renowned doctors one can talk about. And now we move on to another interactive session before we go on to the Glittering Awards ceremony.